Southern California, and on the web at praiseyahuwah.com, announcing the kingdom of Yahuwah. And now it's time for Truth with your servant host, Denya Cajaliero. Shabbat shalom, good morning, and dear lovers of Yahuwah, Shabbat keepers, friends, those of you joining us who have never heard the name of Yahuwah, we hope that you'll enjoy what you'll be hearing from us today. We pray that Yahuwah's loving spirit, His Ruach, be upon us as we declare His word, His covenant, His truth, and all that that entails. We first and foremost, as Yahuwah's people, want to recognize the fact that covenant is that which is our foundation. And we make no apologies for the covenant of Yahuwah, because it is absolutely everything that we live for. And so, by design, the covenant has been set forth as a foundation for you and I to keep, and especially reflect upon on this set-apart day. You'll develop a love for Yahuwah's covenant, the covenant truths that you have never known before, the longer that you allow this covenant, this truth that He has provided to you, that you have come across one way or another, the longer that you associate with it, the more you will love it, the more that you will see that this is the true word of our Father, our Creator, and of His Son, who He sent to declare purposely. Now, where religions declare a lot of things, this is a very simple thing, yet very multifaceted, very complex in its words, in its statements, in its understanding. You could spend a lifetime on just a few scriptures learning the deeper meanings of the covenant. So we'll start off reading the covenant this morning, as we oftentimes do, and as we should do in our private lives every single Shabbat, if not every day. Have His words listed on your wall in your house. Have His words in your mind and in your heart. Think about His covenant as you're going to work, as you're coming home, while you're working. Declare His covenant to your friends, to your family, because it is only by and through the covenant, which is synonymous with our Savior and synonymous with our Father, the great name of Yahuwah, through only all of this may you have eternal salvation, as our Savior declared in Matithyahu 19. And it says in Exodus 21 through 18, Almighty, eternal, loving Yah of all creation spoke these 10 words, saying, I am Yahuwah, the Almighty, eternal, loving Yah, creating His people, who brought you out of the land of Mitzri, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no foreign gods before your face. You shall not manufacture nor consume for yourselves any contamination, nor any image to worship, not of anything that is in the heavens above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow yourself down to it, nor serve them, for I, Yahuwah, your Almighty loving Yah of all creation, I am the only Almighty eternal loving One. The sins of the fathers are passed on to their children, even to the third and fourth generation of those who ignore me. Yet I send loving invitations 1,000 times to every generation of those who seek to love me and to keep my words. Do not treat my name, Yahuwah, Almighty loving Yah of all creation, as unimportant, for I cannot hold him sinless who treats my name as unimportant, for it is the first gate of salvation. Remember the Shabbat day to keep it set apart. You shall labor 6 days and do all your work, but the seventh day is set apart. You shall labor 6 days and do all your work, but the seventh day is the pledge day to Yahuwah, the Almighty, Eternal, Loving Yah, who is creating His nation. You shall not do any work in it. You, your son, your daughter, your male servant, your female servant, nor your livestock, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days Yahuwah made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but He rested on the seventh day. Yes, Yahuwah rested on the seventh day. Many friends wonder, how can the world be created in 6 days and rest the seventh day? Well, how can our Savior have raised Lazarus from the dead after 3 days of decomposition? Decomposing, stinking, it says in the scripture. His body falling apart, literally, just becoming part of the earth, going back to dust. And yet He raised Him from the dead. See, not everything can be put into a simple scientific package because we are so ignorant. Scientists are so ignorant. People are so ignorant. We are like ants. Imperfect insects. But we think we know so much. And not everything can be explained perfectly. But if our Savior can raise a man from the dead, decomposing 3 days, then Yahuwah absolutely is a sign we see can create the earth in 6 days. If that's the literal meaning of that term, and if it be not, the only thing that matters is that the six parts of the creation time period was such, and the seventh part was rest. So we don't have to become focused on things we don't understand and lose our understanding of what is being said here. Keep the Shabbat day, because therefore Yahuwah blessed the Shabbat day and made it set apart. Now honor your father and your mother in Yahuwah, that your days may be long in the land which Yahuwah, Almighty, Loving Yah of all creation, gives to you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit infidelity. You shall not steal. You shall not give a false testimony to a near one. You shall not lust after anything about your near one's house. And you shall not seek after your near one's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your near one's. Furthermore, friends, our Savior was asked, which of those commandments are the greatest? And He replied in Scripture, and it says here, all my words are perfected in this. You shall love Yahuwah, your Almighty One, with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your resources. And then also, part of this royal commandment was that we love your near ones, our neighbors, as ourself. And so, love is the theme of all 10. It's not one specific law, but it's the entire law. Simple, yet complex. How we love one another, though, became imperfect, became sinful at the time of Adam and Chua, known as Eve. When Shaitan came and helped to influence, and they did turn away, just as the fallen angels down from the heavens turned away from Yahuwah, just as Shaitan, his very self, turned away from Yahuwah, in that sinful state, how can we love one another properly? We can't. So Yahuwah gave His only begotten Son that He would be the example of love. And so born the new commandment, the amendment to the covenant truths, not to do away with, but for us to keep even more fully how we must love our near one. He said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just like I have loved you. You also must show love for one another. By this will others know that you are my true disciples, by the way we hold love for each other." So friends, in our walk, how do we know if we are Yahuwah's people? The only way is if we are keeping his covenant of love. If we are doing everything that we can, if our daily walk is a walk of love, do you find yourself doing something and checking yourself and realizing, wait a minute, I have an ulterior, sinful motive to this action I'm about to produce? This is not love. I need to walk in Yahuwah's love. So I will stop myself right now. And I will not do this thing or that thing that is not love. Because it's only by doing these commandments of love that we can say that we are Yahuwah's people. So people oftentimes have a double motive. And sometimes they don't stop and think about what they're doing. Even Christians, many people of Yahuwah, many people of many different religions that keep different names, will claim that they love their Savior, will claim that they love their Creator. And yet, they don't stop and think about what it is they're saying and doing in their everyday life, from the littlest things to the great things. And they'll find, many will find, if not most, that they do not walk in love. They walk in a false love. You see, they do not know the true example of our Savior, because if they did, they would only act in love and not in judgment, not in the tearing down of others, but in the building up of others, in the unification of the love that we hold, which is the love that our Savior gave us, loving one another just like He loved us. So it's with great love that Dee and I come to you today and say that we love you with no ulterior motive. We come here only to declare Yahuwah's love and nothing else. We accept no donations. In fact, even on our YouTube channel, somebody asked recently why we don't have comments enabled on our videos. Well, it's for three reasons, really. Number one, because all praise, honor, glory should only go to Yahuwah. Number two, the truths that we do our very best to speak, and not perfectly, of course, are not open to debate. Every single person will have a walk and a thought process, and not one will be exactly the same as another. So we don't open up to debates, because debating is not the love of Yahuwah. Our Savior showed this. He did, because there were times when he would simply say nothing at all. The statement that if you don't have something beautiful and loving to say, it would be better to say nothing. So we love one another and we show this. This is how we know that we are brothers and sisters in Yahuwah. This is how we know that we are His people, that we are true family, that we love one another. without the complications of the world. Love is forgiveness. We forgive one another as well. We say, you know, we're not perfect in so many ways, and this is so true. And yet, there is one who came to bring forgiveness to those seeking, to those loving. And we love one another and do our very best to walk in that example. And the other reason that we don't have comments on our YouTube channel is because we're not seeking donations. We're not seeking support. We just seek your love. Because that's what the scriptures say. And so the more simple we make our personal ministry, each one of us, all of you, as we walk, the more simple it is for those we're trying to help to come to the covenant. We don't want to overcomplicate the covenant and the love of the covenant and the walk in Yahuwah's love, especially now as we are living in these days. So, let our walk, our example, be in the pathway, no, the way, really, of our Savior and His example. His example as the vine that all the fruit of all those who love Yahuwah grow upon. This fruit, these sweet grapes that grow upon these vines, before they are ripe, can be sour to many, can be bitter. So we allow ourselves to grow on the vine. We don't want to be torn off. We don't want to be considered sour tasting, unripe for the coming fruitful picking that will occur when our Savior comes. The harvesting time that we want to definitely be ripe and full for. When He comes, He'll say to you, "You are a beautiful, sweet, ripe, pleasant and desirable fruit growing upon my vine." What are those fruits, friends? Revelation 22 says that there's 12 fruits, does it not? 12 fruits, because there's a fruit for every single month, it says. 1 and 2. Let's read that real quickly. It says, "And he showed me a river of water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of Elohim and of the Lamb. In the middle of its street, on either side of the river, was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits." It bore 12 fruits. It bore 12 fruits. Each tree yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Now, friends, you might be asking yourself right about now, yes, my scriptures say this, but why does my scriptures also say in Galatians 5, 22 and 23 that there are only 9 fruits? And in fact, of those 9, 3 of them are repetitive. They're not unique. They're repeated. So there's really only 6 fruits mentioned uniquely in most Bibles. Yet, Revelation shows that there were truly 12. And they are love, joy, peace, persistence, goodness, faith, humility, discipline, wisdom, honesty, patience, and mercy. And these are the fruits that the scriptures declare clearly. And this is why we know that these are the 12 fruits, even if all Bibles changed and leavened Galatians 5, 22 and 23, removing half of the 12 fruits, just as they removed half of the covenant in Matithyahu, Matthew 19, Mark, and Luke. We know that this is a sign that therefore, as we study Scripture, we're not to be stumbled by allowing the Ruach to give us greater understanding. For what man has changed, Yahuwah's loving Ruach will allow you to put back. You'll do it because you are the temple of Yahuwah. You are. No man, no church, no cult, no religion, no pope, no elder, no bishop, no minister, nobody but our Savior, under His Father, is between you. And Dee and I love this, because when others may try to come against us now or in the future, we are not beholden to any man, but only to Yahuwah. So this fruit of the Ruach, these 12 fruits, are that which we seek to emulate, to declare, so that we can become sweet, so that our juice bursts with fruits of Yahuwah, a perfect 12 part. So now you know, now you see why there are 12 fruits. But, however, how is it that we can make sure that we are remaining on the vine, growing, becoming fruitful? We're going to read about that today in Matithyahu, or rather, the book of Yahuchanan, John. In that book, we're going to be reading chapters 13 and forward about the vine, about the grower of the vine that we are to remain upon. So let's talk about vines. Let's talk for a moment and understand a little bit about why it is that Yahuwah several times in Scripture refers to fruit and wine and vineyards and farming and harvesting, and all these things that are all surrounding the grape or the fruit. So I looked in online and was seeking to find out a little bit about what is required to grow, not just simply grow grapes. Dee and I grow these grapes that grow on either side of the front of our house on the garage, and they kind of have a little trellis. They grow up and they grow across the garage door of the front of our home to kind of fill it and show that vine. We love grapes, and we love to kind of reflect upon the fact that this house is a house of Yahuwah, and that Yahuwah's Ruach is here with us. And when we come home, when I come home from work and I see this vine, this grapevine growing across my house, I love thinking about our Savior as that vine, protecting. As the vine protects and beautifies, the fruit begins to grow. The grapes begin to dangle from the vine. And it's beautiful. And it declares an abundance. And nothing more beautiful, I think, in my heart than a vine filled with fruit. And so I thought, I want to read a little bit about what is required, not just growing a simple couple of vines like that, But what is required for a vineyard? See, in my family, vineyards go back thousands of years, hundreds of years anyway. More than 1,000 years, we believe, maybe even to the time of our Savior. I come from Italian descent, Roman, way back in the day. And in researching my lineage and understanding what my fathers told me about his father and his father's father, our family has a very rich background in the growing of vineyards. We have a huge vineyard in Italy. Relatives that I do not know, but they have a huge Colliero.com vineyard that they grow grapes. They produce Colliero wines and have done so, and they have produced vines for growing of grapes in that region of Piedmont, northern Italy. And here in California, when our family immigrated to California many decades ago, in Northern California, they began to create vineyards and grow wines, and many are part of the vintner boards of growing grapes. And I knew very little about growing grapes for wine production. Oh, sure, I could grow these two vineyards, these two vines, rather, on the front of my house, but I did not know how to actually, what's required in creating a vineyard. What are some of the rules? Some of the viticultural requirements. So I thought, well, I'm going to look this up today because this kind of applies with what we're going to be discussing in Yahuwah's Word. So the top 10 list of viticultural requirements, I began to read. And as I began to read these top 10 points, I started to realize that these points can also go hand in hand with the way that Yahuwah grows his people and his kingdom. And I was fascinated as I began to look further into each one of these top 10 points and to see the correlation. And I see why Yahuwah uses the vine and the grape and the fruit and so forth. Why his son is known as the vine. Why his father is known as the farmer, the grower. And why you and I are known for our fruits. The first reason it says in a requirement is to make sure that you do have a good site selected. Poor site selection is detrimental to a good viticultural crop. Good air and drainage is essential for frost avoidance. Now, I thought to myself, well, that's interesting because you and I, we've had to leave various religions because the air and the drainage was becoming stagnant in those churches and religions. And many of us have left those religions so that we're not destroyed, so that our fruits can grow and become sweeter. So that cold frost from the lack of good air and drainage doesn't cause the grape to wither away on the vine. It talks about sloped sites, mountainous sites, ridgetop sites are excellent locations. And I thought in this first point, you know, Yahuwah talks about the mountains. And he talks about hills and so forth. And much of the scriptures talk about things happening on these mountains and so forth. And I thought, well, that's interesting. Then it talks about a balanced pH, a proper pH. And I thought, you know, that's very interesting in this first point because you and I, do we not have to be balanced in all that we do as Yahuwah's people? That we can go way overboard if we're not careful. And if we do go overboard, are we praising Yahuwah? So he wants you and I to be balanced in all things. Because if you're balanced, then for the long term, you can develop into his beautiful fruit. Then it talks about that east slopes are some of the best slopes, especially in the northern hemisphere. And I thought, well, that's interesting, because the scriptures talk about everything starting in the east and then going out from there. Then also, it talks about the vineyard being free of trees and brush, so they don't choke out. Now, why be free of trees and brush? Did you know that grapes take on the flavors of things that are grown around them? Some vintners will grow roses or other types of flavor-typed plants because their specific grape plant will take on flavors literally from what it is that they plant. This is why it's so important, our association, what we watch on TV, who we hang around with. Those things that are planted near us, we will absolutely take on. Think about just this first point of this viticultural requirement for a successful vineyard. And we see why Yahuwah equates the vineyard with his people and his kingdom. Point number two. Do not select the wrong varieties. Varieties should be chosen based on regional rather than individual winery demand, with price, future demand, and site compatibility being other considerations. Now, what this told me is that as a vintner, as a grower, as a farmer, which Yahuwah is the farmer, the Father is declared, we'll be reading about that shortly, his Son is the vine, and you are the fruit. Does this not apply? Because Yahuwah looks far ahead of what the requirements are going to be for the future. In fact, so far ahead that Shaitan, who thinks that he knows so much, cannot ever see that far ahead. That's why Yahuwah is the greatest farmer, because he knows what's going to be required for the security of that vineyard, its future. Now, the third point is that you've got to be careful about how you plant. It says your rows need to be very straight, evenly placed. And it's very precise in its width, in its depth. It's very precise in how it's pruned, how deep it should grow. Grafting. That hybrids must be grafted. And to watch out for plagues and all these other things. We know that with Yahuwah's people being imperfect, there have been many plagues, many challenges. But Yahuwah has created a pathway. Remember? His Son the vine. He is our example. He created the way. He created the perfect row for the vineyard to grow, so that we can withstand the coming plagues. He allows us to be tested from time to time, because this testing allows us to grow stronger. The fourth point, trellis mistakes. So a trellis is how you grow the grape upward so that you get more volume. It says a trellis must be designed to handle the leaf and the fruit load of mature vines in rain and high wind. Remember, the leaves of the tree are for the health of his people. And so when Yahuwah does grow you and I, he grows us in such a way so that the pressures of the world that come against us, the winds, the high winds, and the rain, and the storms, allow us to weather those storms, to put down roots properly. Those wooden posts that you trellis up, anchored properly. The tensioners turned and tensioned just right. So Yahuwah allows us, so we're set up for success. Because truly his covenant is the trellis, the training system, the stake that we grow on the vine that wraps around. Our Savior wraps around that wooden post to help us weather the storms. Does he not? Number five, inadequate watering and equipment for watering. Now, the scriptures talk about Yahuwah is waters of life, equating him with and his Ruach with water. If we are not consistently reading his word, yes, there are things that have been twisted in all scriptures. This, in fact, should encourage us to want to read more, to compare more, to understand more. Only those who are not Yahuwah's people will have faith that's actually hurt by the fact that all Bibles are leavened. Yahuwah's true people actually become encouraged, knowing that it is truly Yahuwah we rely upon, and that he'll help us to open up scriptures so that we understand more and more of his truth. Like, for instance, that there are 12 fruits and not truly 9 or 6. We wouldn't have found that if we didn't read and seek in his word daily, if we weren't watered by his word weekly. So watering, proper water, is crucial, is it not, to the farming and the growing of the vine and the fruit upon it. Number six, lack of pest control. Deer, raccoons, birds, to a lesser extent rabbits, skunks, possums, left uncontrolled, wreak havoc on both non-bearing and bearing vineyards. Friends, there are pests all around you, consistently trying to take away your good fruit. Remember, we said that a true person of Yahuwah is someone you will know because they will keep covenant, they will keep his name, and they will do everything in love. So those who do not show that love, that covenant keeping, they may try to tear you down. They may try to take away your fruit. This is one of the reasons why we don't have comments on our YouTube site. Because we don't need comments to take away faith. The word that we're bringing, that His Ruach gives to us, that is what is designed to build us up. And so, adding to the ability for pests to come, this is a pest control, you see. And really, pride control. And all the things beyond the 12 fruits, which the scriptures show in that fifth chapter of Galatians, that are the bad fruits. So we want to stay away from those bad fruits. That's point number 6. Number 7, underestimating labor. This is often a subset of the phenomenon Romance of the Vineyard. People always underestimate the labor required for growing premium wine grapes. Most of the work is not done from a tractor seat, and much of it is semi-skilled, requiring some knowledge of grape growing. Thus, much of it will have to be done by you if you want it done right. There's no ready labor pool. The first year is easy. People generally underestimate labor for the second year. Trunk, training, weed control, mid-season, shoot positioning. If you get behind, you usually stay behind. And if you can't get in to effectively spray, then you can lose your crop. Underestimating labor. Friends, remember the scriptures say that the workers are few. Pray that Yahuwah bring more laborers. It is your job to labor, to work for Yahuwah. Do something for Yahuwah. What is your calling? You see what Dean and my calling is here on Seventh Days and things that we do for Yahuwah during the week and so forth. You yourself do various things which you do not require anybody to even know about. You labor for Yahuwah, pray for more laborers, and don't underestimate the work at hand. Don't underestimate the fact that you might be that casting of seed, that Yahuwah might be using you as a laborer to cast some seed to grow, that He will help grow. Now, point number 8, underestimating cost. Viticulture has been referred to as boutique farming. Establishment costs for vinifera can run more than $10,000 per acre. And if you have to hire it all done, hybriding costs less, but likely will run thousands more. This, of course, doesn't include land, buildings, equipment, etc., etc., etc. The point is here, friends, do not underestimate the price that we may have to pay for doing Yahuwah's work, for being the laborers. Yahuwah certainly did not underestimate the cost, for He gave His only Son, did He not? And His Son willfully went through and loyally gave His own life. Certainly, they did not underestimate the cost, and neither should we. And when those costs increase in our life, physically, mentally, emotionally, materially, we're ready for it. Number 9. Over-reliance on experts, quote-unquote experts. How many times, this person says, have I heard, but X told me to plant Y. Yes, Y is disease-resistant, but brings almost no market value. What a deal. See, there's an incredible amount of bad advice propagated many times in the growing of grapes. There is no excuse for ignorance, he says. How true this is. If we rely on other men, if you rely only upon me, Denya, even, for the truths that you're to receive by Yahuwah, then you could set yourself up for failure, possibly. Or any man, any person on this earth. We must rely on the expert, the true expert that is our Savior, and we can only do that by His teachings, His truths. And if we rely on these other religions and teachers and preachers and ministers and popes and priests, so-called fathers, etc., we can set and will set ourselves up for failure. There is only one true expert. Yahuwah sent His Son to provide us the proper way to grow. Number 10, and finally, this one's called Philosophical Mismatch. This is more important than it may sound, it says. If you are interested in quick returns, or have what I call an annual crop mentality, grape growing may not be in your best interests. Financial returns, planning, and satisfaction are all long term. As with any pursuit, it helps immensely if you have a passion for growing grapes and perhaps making and consuming fine wine. Passion will drive you over and through the inevitable rough patches. Yes, you can do this just for the money, but you probably won't be satisfied with the long-term results. How true this is! Do we have the passion to sustain us for Yahuwah and His covenant? Or do we have a philosophical mismatch where there's other things that pull us away from His covenant? Other things that get in our way, our mind's eye, in staying focused. Do we do it just simply for financial reasons? Or do we do it because we have a passion for the love of the fruit alone? These are the most successful vintners. They become one with their grape. And so, as I read these top 10, you might see how this just amazingly fits in why Yahuwah chose the vine and the grape, the fruit of life, why He is known as the great farmer. And I hope that the top 10 list of these viticultural requirements blesses you this morning as much as it blessed me, as Yahuwah gave this to me just by chance this morning, as He always does. We rely upon Him in our hour of need, and He brings us exactly what we need for truth and for success. And so we praise Yahuwah alone and thank Him. We now begin our scripture reading from the great scripture words of Yahuwah, His people, prophets, and those disciples who worked in that work as laborers for His great vineyard, His kingdom, which is the great vineyard of Yahuwah. And we hope that you were blessed by the information about the grape, the growing of the vine, and all the intricacies of it. We see how incredible Yahuwah is in His design, and how exacting everything is, how our walk is for a certain reason in a certain way. Let's turn together to the book of John, or more truthfully, Yahuwah Kanan. This would be the chapter of 13. And today we're going to be reading from the Scriptures, the 1998 version of the Scriptures. And you can read from any Bible. We like to read from various Bibles from time to time because it's not in that particular Bible that we have salvation, but it's in the truth of Yahuwah's covenant that we have the salvation that we have. And so it matters not, but what does matter is that we compare Scripture and grow in our understanding. And reading various translations helps us in doing so, does it not? So now let us begin in verse 1. It says, "And before the festival of the Passover, Yahuwah, knowing that his hour had come, that he should move out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And supper taking place, the devil having already put it into the heart of Yehuda from Kerioth, son of Shimon, to deliver him up, Yahuwah, knowing that the Father had given all into his hands, and that he had come from Eloyahim and was going to go back to Eloyahim, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, and having taken a towel, he girded himself. After that, he put water into a basin, began to wash the feet of the taught ones, and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. And so he came to Shimon Kepha, and he said to him, 'Master, do you wash my feet?' And Yahuwah answered and said to him, 'You do not know what I'm doing now, but you shall know after this.' And Kepha said to him, 'By no means shall you wash my feet ever.' Yahuwah answered him, 'If I do not wash you, you have no part with me.' Shimon Kepha said to him, 'Master, not my feet only, but then also wash my hands and my head.' And Yahuwah said to him, 'He who has had a bath does not need to wash except his feet, but is clean altogether, and you are clean, but not all of you.' For he knew who would deliver him up. So he said, 'You are not all clean.' So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments and sat down, he said to them, 'Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and master, and you say, "Well, for I am." Then if I, master and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example, that you should do as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is an emissary greater than he who sent him. If you know these teachings, blessed are you if you do them. I do not speak concerning all of you. I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture might be filled, 'He who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me.' Now I say to you, before it takes place, that when it does take place, you shall believe that I am. Truly I say to you, he who receives whomever I send receives me. He who receives me receives him who sent me." So when Yahuwah had said this, he was troubled in spirit and witnessed and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, one of you shall deliver me up." The taught ones looked at one another, doubting of whom he spoke. One of his taught ones, whom Yahuwah loved, was reclining in the bosom of Yahuwah. Shimon Kepha then motioned to him to ask who it was of whom he spoke. Leaning back on the breast of Yahuwah, he said to him, "Master, who is it?" So Yahuwah answered, "It is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread when I have dipped it." And having dipped the bread, he gave it to Yehuda from Kerioth, son of Shimon. And after the piece of bread, Shaitan entered in to him. So Yahuwah therefore said to him, "What you do, do quickly." No one at the table knew why he said this to him. For some were supposing, because Yehuda had the bag, that Yahu was saying to him, buy what we need for the festival, or that he should give somewhat to the poor. So having received the piece of bread, he then went out straightway. And it was night. So when therefore he went out, Yahu said, now the son of Adam has been esteemed, and Eloyahim has been esteemed in him. If Eloyahim has been esteemed in him, Eloyahim shall also esteem him in himself, and straightway esteem him. Little children, yet a little while, and I am with you. You shall seek me, and as I said to the Yehudi, where I am going, you are unable to come. I now also say to you, a renewed command I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all know that you are my taught ones, if you have love for one another. Shimeon Kepha said to him, Master, where are you going? And Yahu answered him, where I am going, you are unable to follow me now, but afterwards you shall follow me. So Kepha said to him, Master, why am I unable to follow you now? I shall lay down my life for you. Yahu answered him, shall you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly I say to you, the cock shall crow at all until you have denied me three times. So this scripture, chapter 13, so much in it. He talks about where he came from, where he was going to, truly his father. It showed the humility our master had and has, washing the feet of his own people. And would they not accept that humility, they would not be his people, he said. Because we accept the love from one another, the love that our Savior teaches us, we should accept the love from one another. What is love? It's a true walk, is it not? For our Savior did not give his disciples money and make them wealthy. No, what he gave them was love, mercy, humility, teachings, bread of life, things other than man's coin. And that's what we give to one another, is it not? Our love. I feel your love this morning, especially so many of you giving it. Thank you. The love that we accept, the love that we give, the measure of the love that our Savior gave. As he knew he was about to give his life, that he would go away soon, that he would suffer for a time. And then to have Shaitan enter in among his people. Friends, let this be an understanding today. Be very, very careful. Even those who we associate with can be possessed of evil and badness, just as Yehuda the Iscariot was possessed literally by Shaitan. Shaitan literally came into him. You see, while we are on this earth suffering, as we do, we know that badness is all around us. We don't take it for granted. The world is being taught that evil doesn't exist, that you can do magic, you can do sorcery, you can do all sorts of things that are pushed and thrust upon the world through video games, through movies, through music, through TV, through every avenue. People are taking in the evil of Shaitan and wondering why their lives are afflicted. Yehuda Iscariot, who was in charge of the money box, as it says here, who was basically controlled by his lusts, was an easy target for Shaitan. were it not for our Savior's true understanding of Kepha's heart. He would have even entered Kepha, scriptures say, but our Savior went to battle for Kepha. Look out for who you may pray for, my friends, so that you can battle for those in need, those who Shaitan is about to sift like chaff. Please pray for the needy. Please pray and fight as prayer warriors for those suffering or about to suffer. Yehuda was so far gone from the very beginning that our Savior knew it. He knew it all along. But he was allowed to be among the 12 for you and I today to learn about this teaching. It shows you the mercy of our Savior as well. The path he was on. The straight path to Yahuwah that he did not waver from. It would have been very easy for him to do many things, but he did just so, as the vine growing, tended by his Father. And yet Kepha still had his little idiosyncrasies. We've read in various books of him saying over and over, I would never betray you. I'm here for you. I love you and you alone. But our Savior knew that he wasn't perfect, even if Kepha did not know his own heart. Frankly, you and I, we do not know our own hearts. That's why we have to pray and very deeply for our family, for ourselves, for our friends and loved ones. This is a true battle, a true war against things unseen. This is what our Savior was preaching and teaching. He taught the communion of the bread and the wine, the remembrance of what he did. He taught the love of Yahuchanan, John, as John laid against his chest. You know, in other cultures, friends, if a man holds hands with another man, they will do that. It's not considered homosexual. If a man shows love for another man, that's real love and not love that's twisted, it's not considered an unclean type of love. So when Yahuchanan laid his head upon the chest of our Savior, he showed that love that he dearly had for our Savior. He loved our Savior. You know, I look forward to a day when men can love one another in a healthy way and not feel ashamed or not feel that it will be misunderstood. Isn't it sad how today, having love for another man, men hold back their emotions, men hold back love, that ingredient that we need, not just women. See, women, if you notice, they'll love each other, they'll hold each other, they'll give each other a kedusha kiss. In the American culture here in the U.S., everything is so stoic. Everything is so icy cold for men. This is a problem in marriages as well, because that tradition or way of men has also caused a problem within the family unit. So this is a little teaching also that men, you know what? Let us love one another as brothers, true brothers, deeply, you see, in the way of our Savior. That's why our Savior here in this chapter gave us the new commandment, that we love one another in the way that he loved us. That is how we're to love one another. See, it's a renewed commandment also. You can call it a new commandment, but it's truly not new. Because it's truly the original love that we were designed with and yet went away from. And so this is a reminder, a renewed commandment, which is why I really like this version of the Scriptures 1998 Bible in this design. Because it's truly always been with us. It's just that our Savior needed to example it, to bring it back to us. Do you understand? An amania on this. Let's go now to chapter 14. It says in verse 1, "Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in Eloah Yahim. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many staying places, and if not, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I shall come again, and I will receive you to myself, that where I am, you might be too. And where I go, you know, and the way, you know." So Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going, and how are we able to know the way?" So Yahuwah said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father too. From now on, you know him and have seen." Philip said to him, "Master, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." Yahuwah said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. And how do you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak from myself, but the Father who stays in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me. Otherwise, believe me because of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he shall do also. And greater works than these he shall do, because I go to my Father. Whatever you ask in my name, that I shall do, in order that the Father may be esteemed in the Son. If you ask whatever in my name, I shall do it. If you love me, you shall guard my commandments." You see, friends, we know exactly who our Savior is. We know exactly from who he comes. We know exactly that our Savior was in the Father, and the Father was in him. We know that our Savior is the mediator by verse 6, that in order to come to Yahuwah, that the row of vines are true and straight, because the way of that straight path to Yahuwah is only through our Savior. And our Savior said, "The only way you will get there is in my name. Whatever you ask in my name, I shall do." So friends, what you ask when you pray, as you prayer warrior for your friends, your neighbors, your loved ones, yourself, ask carefully, but with faith, knowing that whatever you ask, Yahuwah will do. This is why there's power in the name. This is why it's important that you know the name. Because whatever you ask in my name, in verse 14, I shall do it. This is why you keep his covenant in verse 15. Because if you love him, you shall guard his commandments. This is why his commandments are not done away. After giving us the new love commandment, the renewed love commandment, he immediately says to guard his command? No, his commandments or commands, plural. You see, knowing the name, understanding that you must seek in his word and in other aspects of books and volumes and truths you must seek. How would you know that the name of Jehovah is false if you don't know that there was no J prior to 500 years ago? That there was no Jah sound? That the sound was a Y? That's why it's Yah. That's why Alleluia has been his statement guarding his name Yah through thousands of years. You wouldn't know that if you didn't seek that. You wouldn't know that in the name Jehovah there's a V declared, but there was no V prior to the first century of our Savior in AD. But if you were to seek and learn about the Greek language, you would find there was no va sound. There was a wa and an ah, Yahuwah. You wouldn't know that if you didn't seek. You wouldn't know that if you didn't truly believe that the name was important. If your preacher and pastor says, oh, there's, you know, these are just the English names, go with it. No. We will go with the truth. We will go where the power lies. Where we are protected in the name, like it says in verse 14, that he will do what you ask in his name. And if you don't seek, you wouldn't know the name of Jesus being false. That there was no Jah until 500 years ago, propagated by the Jesuits and prior. That the Zeus in the name of Jesus was a false god. That Zeus worship in the hooked fingers or in TV and television and Zeus worship and pagan worship and infiltration throughout all the religions of the world. Including the religion that you're from right now, that you must seek and learn and reject. There is no excuse. But lo, there will be so few on the road who will hear this and take that pathway. See, it will not be a pathway with tens of millions of people, of which there are in all these religions, Christian and otherwise. No. There will be very few on the path that will keep his commandments, that will keep his name, that will, even though it irritates them at first, still seek to become a pearl of knowledge and truth, to become fruitful as you grow on the vine. Understanding there will be trials and tribulations, there will be winds of change, there will be stormy weather. If you love me, you shall guard my commands, he says. And I shall ask the Father, and he shall give you another helper to stay with you forever. Verse 17, the Spirit of the truth, whom the world is unable to receive, because it does not see him or know him, but you know him, for he stays with you and shall be in you. You see, he's saying the Father's in me, and I am in the Father, and he is in you, because you are in me. And the pathway and the understanding, friends, is so easy. Why do people continue to follow these religious orders? Why? He says, I shall not leave you as orphans. I am coming to you. See, you and I, we feel, as far as this world connection goes, we feel like orphans. We feel like we have no family beyond you and I. But we are with Savior. And yet, He says he will not leave you and I as orphans, that he is coming to you. He will be here soon, friends, and he will take you up to him. You will meet him, and you will be with Master, and you will do his work. So few of you, and yet there will be many. Many who have come before you. Many who are asleep, who will rise, who will be risen, who he will take to him as his coming army. You have a family. Yes, our family is very small right now. And so we long for Master. We long for his return. Verse 19, yet a little while, and the world no longer sees me, but you shall see me, because I live, and you shall live. In that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I in you. He who possesses my commandments and guards them, it is he who loves me. You see that, friends? He who possesses my commandments and guards them, it is he who loves me. The name and the commandments, friends. And he who loves me shall be loved by my Father. And I shall love him and manifest myself to him. Praise Yahuwah. Praise Yahuwah. Praise Yahuwah that he loves you and I so much. Praise be to Yahuwah. So Yehuda, not the one from Kerioth, not the Iscariot, said to him, Master, what has come about that you are about to manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Yahuwah answered him. He said, if anyone loves me, he shall guard my word. Again, talking about his commandments, not the Bible, friends. His word is not the Bible. His word is the commandments. The Bible is written about his commandments. Understand why it is his commandments that are set apart. Why there's power in his covenant. You see, putting your hand on a Bible is meaningless if you don't understand the covenant and guard his covenant. It's keeping covenant that he requires. Loving me, he said, then you shall guard my covenant, my word. And my Father shall love him, and we shall come to him and make our stay with him. He who does not love me does not guard my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but of the Father who sent me. These words I have spoken to you while still with you. But the Helper, the set-apart Spirit, whom the Father shall send in my name, he shall teach you all and remind you of all that I said to you. Peace I leave with you. Peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. So do not let your heart be troubled. Neither let it be afraid. Friends, don't be afraid of what is to come. Rejoice in every single thing that happens. Rejoice. This is why you can rejoice. Even when there are hard times and tough times and not alone in just the good times. Rejoice in everything, knowing there's no need to be afraid. There's no need to let your heart be troubled. You don't need prescription drugs for depression. You only need Yahuwah. You only need his bread of life, his truth. You see, don't let yourself be troubled by the pressures of the world, money. All these things pressure people who are not of Yahuwah. For if they knew Yahuwah, they would not be troubled and they would not be afraid. You heard that I said to you, verse 28, I am going away and I am coming to you. If you did love me, you would have rejoiced that I said, I am going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, that when it does take place, you shall believe. And I shall no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he possesses none at all in me. But in order for the world to know that I love the Father and that the Father has commanded me, so I am doing, rise up, let us go from here. Our Savior loves us so, does he not? And so, being of love and being so loving, this chapter is a chapter of assurance for his people, assuring them of what was happening at that moment, assuring them of what was about to happen, assuring them of what was going to happen in the future, teaching and telling us the importance again of covenant, the relationship of him and the Father and us, and of the Spirit, teaching us how it all fits together and warning us of the badness of the ruler of this world, but saying, don't be afraid, don't be troubled, stand with a smile on your face. It is a great recipe for the walk that is the walk of a true one of Yahuwah's. I know that you look forward to the coming of our Master. I pray that we'll all be able to be brought up to him. I pray that we'll be used. I pray that you and I can be warriors for Yahuwah in not just things here and now, but also what we'll be doing in the future. You see, he said that what he would do now, we would do even more, greater than this. And that is why you're the beginning, the first fruits of the harvest that is to come, friends. You are the people, the covenant keepers of Yahuwah. You are to have the fruit grow within you, the 12 fruits, not only half. Turn now to chapter 15, verse 1. And it all comes together. I am the true vine. My Father is the gardener. Every branch in me that bears no fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes so that it bears more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Stay in me, and I stay in you. As the branch is unable to bear fruit of itself unless it stays in the vine, so neither you unless you stay in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who stays in me, and I in him, he bears much fruit, because without me you are able to do naught. If anyone does not stay in me, he is thrown away as a branch, he dries up. They gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you stay in me and my words, I stay in you. You shall ask whatever you want, and I shall do it for you. In this my Father is esteemed, that you bear much fruit. You shall be my taught ones. As the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Stay in my love. Guard my commandments. If you guard my commandments, you shall stay in my love. Even I, as I have guarded my Father's commands, and stay in his love. Friends, the gardener is Yahuwah. The true vine is our Savior. The covenant that he declares. The branches are his people who bear fruit. The 12. Stay grafted into the vine. Stay growing onto the main branch. Do not dry up. Do not be burned. Stay in his word, his commandments. This is what praises and esteems the Father. When you bear the fruit. That's why if you do things that do not bear good fruit, if you do not do things in a loving way that is of love, instead of having that secret darkness behind what it is you do, but you everything you do for love, and out of love, and in love, and of all the fruit, then you're not sour. You're not bitter, but you're sweet. A bitter heart. There are so many in religiondom. Bitterness fills Christendom. Mercy is required. So he says that these words he spoke. He says in verse 11, I have spoken to you these words that my joy might be in you, that your joy might be complete. This is my command, that you love one another as I have loved you. You see? The way of love. No one has greater love than this, that one should lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you a friend. For all teachings which I heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, that your fruit should remain, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he might give to you. These words I command you, so that you love one another. Because if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, for that reason the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. So if they persecuted me, they shall persecute you too. If they have guarded my word, then they would guard yours too. But all this they shall do to you because of my name, because they do not know him who sent me. And if I had not come and spoken to them, they would have no sin, but now they have no excuse for their sin. See, friends, there's no excuse when you learn the truth about the importance of his name and the importance of keeping covenant. If you decide to turn away, there is no excuse once you learn. And he says it right here. He also says why all these religions, hundreds of millions, if not billions of Christians throughout this world, How can the way and the pathway be few upon it if there are billions of Christians who call upon the name of Jesus? Because they don't know His true name, they don't care for His true name. They don't know His covenant, they don't want to keep His covenant. They're inconvenient. They're an irritant that they reject, they spit it out, instead of accepting it and turning it into the greatest treasure that one could ever hold in their hands. So they will reject you and I, and they shall persecute you and I, and there will be much that will come against us because of His name, His true name, because of the name of the one who sent Him, because of His covenant that they do not know and they do not keep. He who hates me hates my Father as well. If I did not do among them the works which no one else did, they would have no sin, it says. But now they have both seen and have hated both me and my Father. But the word might be filled which was written in their Torah, they hated me without a cause. And when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you, and from the Father, the Spirit of the truth who comes from the Father, He shall bear witness of me. But you also bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. Amaniah. We believe in Yah. Praise Yahuwah for this teaching, friends, because it makes clear what has become so muddied by the world. It makes clear that this command to love one another does not replace His covenant. It complements and completes it. But we have to understand why it would be needed to complete a covenant. So all these teachings are important in understanding how it all fits together. And we don't grow weary, but we remain joyful because, in truth, friends, there will be very few in acceptance of this until the return of our Savior. Until the works that will be done, until much groaning and many pains upon this earth happen. And they will happen, and they must happen. But we draw encouragement knowing that what is happening is by design or foretold. The Shaitan's works are understood. And so our Father has made it clear to us that there will be a great cooling off from the covenant, from the love, from the truth of the name. But in the latter days, that the name will be proclaimed and is being and beginning to be proclaimed, dear friends. Why? Because it is the beginning of the harvest that is to occur. The fruit bearing, the sweet juice that is the words of our Savior. And that juice must come from a sweet grape, which you are. And only from a sweet grape, creating this sweet juice, can this juice then hold itself in wineskins that are anew, to ferment for a time. That this new wine be created. Only first must there be the harvest and the production, the producing of the sweet fruit. the skins, all the tannins, all the beautiful healing aspects of a glass of wine. And we're going to ferment for a while, for a time, just as grape juice must ferment as we're pressed and we're pulled and we're torn, but we remain in the Almighty Word, which is the covenant, and His Son, Yahuwah, and His love, and the Savior that He is for you and I, and the Spirit of Yahuwah, which guides and directs us, and teaches us, and protects us, even though we have afflictions, but that whatever we ask our Savior, He will do. So when things come against us, pray in faith, pray knowing He will do, because we ask it in His name. His name that is the name above all other names, the name that was given Him according to Scripture, of which there was only one name, which is the Almighty loving name, that is Yahuwah. This concludes this seventh-day audio broadcast of It's Time for Truth. I'm your servant host, Denya Cajaliero, and you need to know that your comments, suggestions, and support are very, very important to us here. Please send your contact email directly to praiseyahuwah@yahoo.com. Or go to our contact webpage by clicking on the phone icon at the homepage at www.praiseyahuwah.com. This is the day that Yahuwah has made, so rejoice and be glad in it. Until next week, be a blessing to all, and be blessed.